Katrina and Cheryl. And we have a nice crowd of people, considering we probably have zero or one. So we're gonna start off with Peter and Jella here, and then we'll go to public comment. So Peter, why don't you roll up a chair?
Sure. Thanks for having me.
Thank you. And I know these are comments that Peter and Cheryl passed on. You probably saw those on your emails.
Not all the articles. I've got the article there, but I've got the nuts and bolts of what Peter's email, Article 8 and...
So we'll let Peter go. Go ahead, Peter.
Thanks, Cheryl. And thanks for having me. So I'm here to talk specifically about this information and then about the Harwood Unified School Board in general. So to this specific situation, I've been involved in various degrees with the school board. I was on the school board. I stepped down from the school board because of some concerns I had. And so because of my involvement with both the board and with community groups who have opposed some of the board's choices, I've talked with a lot of members of the community, and so some folks got together and discovered that since this board has existed, and in fact, in the Articles of Agreement that form the board, the population numbers used to create the weights of the board voting totals have been incorrect. And what the mistake was, the mistake is in both the Waitsfield numbers and the Waterbury numbers. And what happened is someone, whoever originally looked at those numbers, incorrectly added two numbers together, both the population of the entire towns of Waitsfield and Waterbury, and also the what's called the census designated places of both Waitsfield Village and Waterbury Village. So the census designated places, in my understanding, are used for statistical purposes only. The people behind the census have decided that certain places, even though they aren't their own incorporated entity, deserve to be counted in the census and deserve to be continuously updated and shared how many people live in that place. So Waitsfield Village and Waterbury Village are those two places within this Harwood Unified School District. So when you add those numbers together, both of those towns have received more weights, as I outlined to you in the handout. And the way it's worked, Waitsfield actually gets more votes, surprisingly, when it all is done out in the math, because the reason for that is because Waterbury has so many extra votes under the current weight. So when you give Waterbury its correct population, you would take off over 1,700 people, and you would take 6.5 weighting points out of 100 away from Waterbury, which equals one extra vote on the board in the way the voting is there. So Moretown has been undervoting since this board has existed, and so have all of the other towns other than Waterbury. And I find two parts of this troubling. One, I really think it was probably a clerical mistake somewhere along the line, but it was signed off on by one of the attorneys that the district used, a gentleman named Chris Leopold from an organization called Wells and Leopold. And we all voted on those articles that had the incorrect numbers in them to form the district. And then I haven't gone back and tried to assess every single vote. We've had various note takers. Some have listed the weights of every vote, some haven't. So I don't know if anything would have changed. But what I do know is that those weights have been used since the beginning of that board to further a narrative, no matter what side of any choice you're on, that Waterbury is huge and Waterbury controls the vote. And it just has had an impact. On top of wanting to have the numbers be accurate, it really makes me question a lot of what has taken place, because that idea of the weight and side conversations when I was on the board and how do you have the votes and these numbers were really used to create a narrative. And well, that's not, well, that's completely, you know, qualitative data. I don't think it could be understated that this is a real problem, that our town and some of the other towns have been undervalued in the weighted voting. And so I really would like the board to switch this as soon as possible. I brought it up last meeting, and I gave them the suggestion, as I shared with you in the language, that they should take one more vote under the current weights, because you would have to vote to make a change. And so I recognize that the board can't do anything unless it votes to do something. So I suggested one more vote under that weight to pause everything else until they can figure out what the solution to this should be. And it would only be the board that could decide that. But I think they should investigate previous votes. I think they should think about what this means, how they can rectify this and move on in a good fashion in the community. And they could still do that, but I was very disappointed to get no reaction from them the other night, and they just knowingly continued to vote, even though that information had been shared. I did receive a couple of messages from members of the board who said that they were going to look into it and see if the numbers were accurate and do all of that. And the numbers are accurate that I have here. I've communicated with the town clerk's offices in both of those towns, and they took 10 seconds for them to confirm the correct number. So it's unfortunate that this never was noticed beforehand. So I don't know if I guess I would suggest that maybe this board reaches out to the school board and says, hey, maybe you should really try to figure this out sooner rather than later to make sure that all future votes are on the up and up and using accurate numbers. I'd be happy to answer any other questions. The other thing I'd like to share first, though, is that
before you move on, let's address this.
Okay.
And then,
okay.
So did everyone have an opportunity, certainly Peter gave a abbreviated talk of what he wrote about here. This is certainly troubling to me. This is going on, and the reaction that you received, or lack of it. This is so serious. I think as a board, we certainly need to send a letter to the board and the supervisory union, Bridget, to let them know our concerns. And probably, I think we should, once we look at this, is pass this on to our attorney. You really have him, for an hour, he look this over and write us an opinion or get in touch with Christina, whoever needs to get in touch with. I think, because this can't go any further, that'll be looked at. I just want to see some transparency, and that board hopefully will take your suggestion and look into it. But until then, I think we need to push on our end to make sure that happens. So, I would move about forward this to our attorney and get appropriate advice from him.
Second.
John seconds. Any further discussion?
Yes. Do you think this should be done in coordination with the other towns affected?
I think what we should do is let the other towns know what we're doing and ask them if they'd like to join us.
Okay.
But we are initiating it.
Mm-hmm. That's good.
Four and four.
Right.
Should you include in your motion the letter to Bridget Nice and the HUUSD school board come from Ron?
Yeah, that's what I asked. Yeah. So move. Any other further discussion? All in favor, vote aye.
Aye.
Aye. Peter, the submission.
So the other piece, the more general concerning issue that I think is happening is that I would like to express to all of you and to all the members of the town that coming up, there will be a very real discussion that could contain the assessment of whether or not our school across the parking lot should exist. And so the other night at the last board meeting, there was a plan on the table to move all 7th and 8th graders to Crossett Brook School instead of having the 7 acres from our town and several of the other Mad River Valley towns go to Harwood. The 7 eighth graders would join the Waterbury and Duxbury students at Crossover School. Board voted that down, really not necessarily because they didn't like the idea, but because they really hadn't answered all the questions or done their due diligence with the research. But in that discussion, while voting that down, it became really clear that they would like to go back to the drawing board and look at all options. And the comment kept coming up from several people, including Bridget Neese, the superintendent, that you know we need to assess all of the assets in the community. And they're just referring to our schools as assets, not community centers that educate our children. That's really troubling to me. And Bridget herself was the one that said, you know, even if that means having the difficult conversation of closing schools, you know, all of this needs to be assessed. And I don't have any answers. All I can do is continue to call on them to look at the research. As an educator myself, the research clearly shows, in my opinion, that losing a school in a town like Moretown would absolutely decimate our town. Because we don't have many other economic drivers here that would attract young families, and families wouldn't move here, property values would go down. I've seen the research that has played out in other states, turning towns like Moretown into ghost towns that don't have elementary schools. Mm-hmm. So I would like all of you to know, and I would like the people of the town to know that. This conversation is going to become very real very quickly. And while the unified board would have to get Moretown voter approval to close a school over the next few years, as of July 1st, 2021, which in the terms of closing a school is right around the corner, all they need is 2/3 of that unified school board to vote in favor of closing any one of these schools. And that could come true.
No town vote,
correct. Legislators that were either for or against Act 46 will kind of all say this wasn't the intent of that law, but intent or not, we're the prime example of that coming true. It ramped up last winter, it paused for a little bit, now it's ramping up again with the no vote on the middle school change. Let's look at all the assets. And I would just like you and all the people of the town to know that this is not just hearsay from a few folks. This is not just hysteria and trying to fight something just for the sake of fighting it. In my view, it's a very real and very scary conversation. It's going to be had very, very soon. So that's what I would say there. And the side piece of that is, in my opinion, and it's the reason I'm not on the board anymore and wanting to be able to come do things like this and talk openly as a community member, is that I don't think the board has shown that they want to do research and want to gather all the information. My opinion is that they want to jump to decisions. And they want to think that they have a hive, you know, some sort of hive intelligence that exists in that room without bringing in the outside experts. An example would be a couple of meetings ago, they chose to fill the seat that I vacated, and several of the board members went out of their way to make excuses as to why the letter that you all sent didn't really matter. And they thought that they knew better than you, and it wasn't just enough for them to vote for the other candidate, which is fine. That's their power as the board, but to actually dismiss a group's opinion is troubling to me. So I'm here just sharing my concerns about the fact that this school is going to be part of a very real conversation about whether or not it should still be a school in the next few years.
Can I ask you a question about that vote? If your numbers are correct, and I'm sure that your numbers are correct, how would that have affected the vote?
This last middle school vote, it would have stayed the same.
For the For the,
For
the director, for appointing a director?
Yes, Kristen still would have not had enough votes to become one of the school directors. She would have still been short by 0.8 of 1%.
And Linda would have still.
Yep. The other layer to that, this is a related but side conversation. There are many people in the community that think that the weights should not even exist, and we should give one vote to one voice at that table. And if you look at it that way, there were 12 board members in attendance, and 6 voted for Kristen, so 6 didn't. It was a tie, and who knows what happens there. But the reality is that we're living in this weighted world, and using the accurate weights that I have, it still would have been short.
Okay. Yeah, just on that piece, I just want to mention that whole nomination process. I think that was bad on that. I think we ended up with Linda. I think we ended up with a good representative from Moretown. I think just the whole process and the lack of transparency from them and forwarding on those things to us in the last hour was really, that was the portion.
And I agree with you there. I have no bad feelings for Linda at all.
But yeah, just when it came down was really unfortunate, and it shows. To me, it shows like how we do business there, and I'm not impressed one bit at all. So certainly, I echo your comments, and hopefully, community members show up at those meetings. Where our hands are tied as much as yours are, but I think a loud voice. We need to make sure it's a transparent process. At the end of the day, who knows what happens with places being closed. I don't think there should, but I want to make sure before any decisions are made, it needs to be a transparent, open process where we're all things are looked at. And, it's not going to happen unless there's a real big pushback.
I have a question. I was just hoping for an explanation because you may be familiar with it. When Linda was elected, it looks like they evaluated each candidate individually instead of seeing how many votes each would get in aggregate. And I didn't understand that process. It looked very strange from the outside.
Yeah, so the board chair has described it that the only way that they can vote is to have a motion for a candidate. And then once that motion is on the table and there's a second, then they can vote whether they want to elect that candidate. And then if that fails, then they'll look for a motion for another candidate. That's the process that they've been using for that.
Yeah, I've never seen anything.
Because hypothetically, they could take a vote and then do a motion. So I don't see that limitation. It just doesn't make sense to me. It just doesn't seem to give all the candidates a fair shot. Particularly since the order they come up is based on individual nomination.
Correct.
It just seems entirely unfair.
Mm-hmm. Right, someone could have more votes, but you never get them. Yeah, mm-hmm.
Yeah, just really is bizarre. But again, it's the way they do things in a bizarre way. So, anything else?
No, thank you.
I have one more question.
Sure.
Going way back. When the vote was presented to the people, whether to form a union, whether to merge, mm-hmm. were the numbers that you're talking about tonight, were those presented to the voters as weighing? As what
yes.
would Moretown have?
Yes.
Your numbers were?
No. It was the incorrect population.
So it was incorrect population right from the get-go.
For Waitsfield and Waterbury, which then makes all the weights incorrect. Yes.
So it starts really at the beginning.
It starts at the beginning. I contacted people in the elections department at the Secretary of State's office, mm-hmm. and the only thing they had to tell me was that if you want to challenge the accuracy of a vote, you need to do it within 15 days mm-hmm. of the vote happening. And so now. Or over 2 years, unfortunately. So he didn't really have any advice from me, but the gentleman I spoke to there.
Okay. except maybe it will make people aware of what's going on.
Right.
Now.
Right. Well, they have an opportunity to correct it, and the board does.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what we do. Thank you, Peter.
Thank you.
Appreciate you taking the time.
So maybe we send that whole copy to you.
All right, so let's go ahead and move into public comments. And do we have anyone here for public comments? Mike?
I don't know if this is an appropriate time, but I just wanted to address something that came up at the last board meeting regarding the listers' use of errors and omissions. Would that be okay for me to
do? Well, that would be a business we can put in now, Mike, if you want.
Okay.
Why don't you?
I just want to clarify what I think is a misunderstanding on how the listers are using errors and omissions for corrections to the grant list. I believe it was reported to the board last time that we're not using those when there's been a change due to a grievance hearing or a BCA hearing. That's my understanding of what you guys were informed. In fact, we are, okay? What I think may have been confusing is that we're not using errors and omissions to change the grant list this year. If someone is coming in with a request to update information due to the tax map corrections, if they didn't grieve originally during the grievance process. Does that make sense?
It does.
Okay. So just to be clear, if someone had a grievance hearing with us and supplying us additional information after the grievance hearing that allows us to make a change due to a tax map correction, we'll use errors and omissions on that. BCA hearings, anything that came down, we're using that to make changes. But if someone didn't go through grievance and they come in with additional information, we're asking them to wait till next year and we'll change in the next year, which is our standard procedure for making changes and evaluations.
Yeah, that makes sense. The process was there, but they didn't make it. So yeah. No, we just wanted to, and obviously we were getting the grant list changed on the people that grieved. That's all we were wanting to make sure that happens.
Yeah.
Or if they grieved, they would grieve those. Very good.
Great. Thank you.
Thanks, Bob.
Thank you.
Anyone else for?
Hi, my name is Deborah Carroll. I have spoken with John and Cheryl.
Yes.
Hi. Nice to meet you guys. I recently purchased, my partner Steve Reisig and I recently purchased the DiCarlo house right next to the fire station. I understand, so after we moved in, I hadn't noticed this one when we were in the purchasing process. There's a culvert that empties out near the river and it flows approximately like 15, 20 feet along the edge of my property, and it's eroding really significantly. I've spoken with John about it a little bit, we just haven't had a chance for him to come out and look at it. I understand that there is a sidewalk project, and I'm not even positive that this is the correct form, if I should be here.
That's a good place to start.
Yep. Good, thank you. So I'd like to have somebody come out and take a look at it. I understand that there's a sidewalks project.
Yes.
That is going to be taking a look at the storm drainage culverts, because that's where the water comes from. It drains from the road under my property, and then it goes out along. And I have a real concern that this bank is going to continue to erode, and it's already started to undermine that part of my property. And it would be real nice if we could move. I don't know what the schedule is for getting things done there, but if I could have somebody come out and take a look at it really soon and maybe get something in there before winter, even if it's just to fill the ditch, the bottom of the ditch with riprap. I don't know, I'm not an engineer, but that's my observation of other drainage situations. It may help to do it. My real concern is not just that it will undermine that part of my property, which is really nice along the river, but my leach field is up just beyond that. And once it undermines that, it's going to move on to my leach, where my leach field is, and then I've got really big problems.
Sure.
So my request to you then is to possibly see if there's some way to expedite this process to get this looked at, evaluated, and possibly some work done before the winter sets in.
Wayne, are you familiar with that?
Yeah, and I believe that culvert is part of the replacement.
It is.
It is, yes.
So I don't know the failure that she's looking at right now, whether that would be a state issue or whether the town.
Well, it is a part of the catch basin project.
Yeah.
I very unsuccessfully have been trying to get Pat Travers to finish the deed easement for signatures. And I believe John has been in contact with.
And that's why we haven't got back in touch with you.
Well, I spoke to John once or twice.
Yeah, this is John.
I'm John.
Oh, John.
I'm Jason.
But either way, we're not gonna get this project done this year. And what she's looking at is, it sounds serious enough that maybe we ought to have just
March. I tried to push the project along with the state the other day a little bit, and I got backed off a little bit from the state because, number one, the plans aren't done yet, and the plans aren't done because of that drainage that is going to be fixed. Number two, they don't want us to go out to bid because they don't think the town will get the best price this year. They would want to go out to bid in the winter, so we'll get contractors when they're lining up their work in the spring.
But what we will do is, I'll, Ray, can you go with Martin?
I can try.
Try, or follow, maybe not with him, but we'll have Martin go. He's our road guy. We'll find out if there's something that needs to be done immediately to stop the erosion prior to the project start.
Thank you, I appreciate it.
We'll have an evaluation on that, and then we'll have Ray take a look at it. Ray is an engineer with the construction company down the road. So we'll get in touch with you, or feel free to get back to Cheryl in the next week or so. We'll let someone out there soon to take a look at it.
Thank you.
I don't remember whose culvert is that?
It's a state culvert.
It's a state culvert.
So.
But we just want to immediately get out there.
Yeah.
And so we can report to get Hoskins, if there's something that needs to be done that needs to be at the state, we can contact him just so that you don't find your leach field in the river.
Mm-hmm. I don't think that will happen this year.
No, I understand, but we just want to get this
down the road. But there's, mm-hmm. there's a nice little sitting area down there, just above the river that I need to see undermined. And it's kind of a hazard too, because when people are down there, stay away from this area. There's about a 4-foot drop right there into a ditch.
Right, and it may be the state's responsibility, but we'll figure that out.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for being cooperative with that.
Yep.
Sure, absolutely. I'm happy to do
that. Yeah, because what's happening is, in case you don't know, the whole sidewalk on the other side of the road is going to be replaced with all the catch basins. There's 3 or 4 catch basins along the road where all this water comes down. So it's going to be quite an improved project.
Yeah, and I think that at least 2 of those, the storm drains, and be out in that culvert that goes right down.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So they're going to improve the size of the piping and get everything correct. So hopefully they
get some erosion control.
Excellent.
Thank you.
Thank you for coming in, and welcome to town.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Yeah, it's a nice place out there.
We're very happy.
Yeah, wonderful town.
Where were you prior to coming here?
Burlington, Vermont, although it's funny, I moved to Louisville, Kentucky for 25 years. I just moved back 2 Marches ago. Deborah was from Maine for 25 years and just moved back. She was from Williston. We both moved back to Vermont and met and
think about
here we are.
I didn't know where Moretown was when I went to UVM.
Yeah.
I grew up in Williston, though, so it's so this is kind of my old stomping ground. I used to ski back there all the time. School over here when it was a ski school.
Yeah, there's a nice little community. There's, on Friday nights, every once a month, they have something at the town hall, open mic that goes on sometimes.
It was just this last Friday, so it'll be next month.
Oh, cool.
Halloween, get about like 400 pieces of candy.
Yeah. Well, Carlo told us Halloween in great big letters on this paper,
That'll be it's fun. I mean, they have a party at the town hall or at the school, and then all the kids go out around like 5 or 6 o'clock, and there's a couple hundred of them that come from all over. It's really, it's awesome. A good time.
trying to stock up.
All right.
I won't do it too early, because then I'll leave it.
Well, very good, well, thanks for coming in.
Yeah, thanks.
Welcome to stay around. So Cheryl, want to go ahead and report to communications?
Yes, overall, the 2018 budget standings to date is about $6,385 deficit.
Oh, this is new budget surgery.
So that's not bad. Montgomery Timber appeal, Gillis just filed in court, I sent you that information today. Request the information from Montgomery Timber to present at the trial, so it looks like there's plans to be a trial.
Now, Paul does understand when they talk about Town Trail 17, it's the one that goes across Calvin Blodgett's property. I hope he understands all that.
Well, he should, he's got the copy of the new map and everything, and knows.
Because, I mean, you know that, you know, going back with Claire Lathrop and everything, they were using the other one that wasn't Town Trail 17.
It sounds to me like Montgomery Timber is talking with the Blodgetts.
Okay.
And Montgomery Timber is gonna work out something to log their land and place a bridge on Blodgett's property.
Uh-huh.
So this is basically getting at some.
Kind of, but,
they didn't really talk about that.
Yeah. Which leaves the other landowners that are up there not being able still to get to their land. So Guy Martin is gonna call this Montgomery Timber, so I don't know if something's happened since then. I haven't heard that anything has. But by reading Paul Gillis's information that he sent yesterday, or last week, that it looks like it's going to trial. What I sent you today looks like he has questions for Montgomery Timber.
Is this one we talked about?
Yeah.
So go ahead with that one.
Go ahead, is this one here?
So it leads me, you know, for your decision-making process, whether you want Paul to stick with this or I did notice that he's CCing another person in the office. I looked up that other person and he does have experience with zoning, municipal zoning and environmental. But this has really got to do with roads, properties.
I mean, that's Paul's specialty to roads, but.
It is.
Well, I mean, I brought that up because in reading that, you know, Montgomery Timber and Claire Lathrop were talking about in the past when they put a bridge across using Town Trail 17. They never used Town Trail 17.
So Paul Gillis has the new survey that shows the discontinued trail.
Mm-hmm.
He specifically has it. I sent it to him. He acknowledged it. He got it. So he should know that.
When they're talking Town Trail 17, they actually mean that part that was so-called that goes between the river between Travis and Cow's Park.
Yeah, but he did ask in those questions why Montgomery Timber says that the new access is too steep.
Mm-hmm.
You know.
Well, what he didn't ask is he didn't ask why the proposed trail location is different from the town trail, the old Town Trail 17 location in these parameters. He's saying, why is this unusable? Then not why is it worse? Now, I agree with what John was saying. It looks likely that they're confusing the traditional access with the old town trail.
Correct, yeah.
Yeah.
Correct.
And as far as the old town trail, that bank was rebuilt. And it really isn't a whole lot better than
there is now, correct, right?
And if he's talking about the traditional access, you've got nothing to do with it.
Exactly. And that's why.
So I don't know if the questions he's asking will point that out.
Maybe, John, you want to talk to Paul, or should I give Paul a call just so that we are clear that he knows that that, because I think that needs to be clarified, that he's making sure that he's talking, and he knows that the old 17 is.
Either way, if you want to.
I'll give him a call tomorrow morning.
He may just be trying to get them to respond to his interrogatory number 3. Please describe it, and if he describes it, it isn't that simple.
Yeah, I was thinking that as well, but trying to trap him, but I think you're too smart for that.
Finance committee, you asked if Sherilyn would agree to be appointed on the finance committee. She is willing to take an appointment. You still want to do it?
Yeah, and we would need the select board would need to approve that.
Get to that new business.
Lastly, we're on a time limit as far as health insurance goes for re-upping the employees. Do you plan to contribute the same as what you did in 2018? Which was...
I think and we had held that from the year before, I think prior, right?
Yeah. So what you did was you set how much you're going to contribute, mm-hmm. and the employee can take whatever plan, you know, ABC, whatever.
How did that come out? Did anyone go above their plan from?
Everyone last year has platinum plan, so we all had to pay a little bit
right,
more.
I guess that was my point.
This year, Vermont League of Cities and Towns has rates for 2019 from the VRS options, the Blue Cross Blue Shield options. There is no platinum plan, but the rates, the deductible is the same. $1,300 deductible. It's $100 deductible for prescriptions, and then $5 and $50 and 50%. So it's pretty much comparable with the platinum plan, but the platinum plan have went up from this year you were paying $630.65 was the principal, and now it's $786.86. Whereas if the employee chooses to go with the BRS plan, their premium would be $686.76. So the town would be covering all but like 50% of a single plan, which was about what you did last year.
And it was comparable to the...
It's pretty comparable to the platinum. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't complain about it.
The people that had to pay last year said that with their raise, it was like a wash. They didn't get a raise. It was almost exactly. Mm-hmm.
But it sounds like that would not be the case this year. It would be a real raise.
Possibly.
Yeah, there is one.
So I think that would be, so we haven't looked at the whole budget, but if we held flat the last 2 years, or this would be 2 years holding flat. It's giving them the plan that's certainly Sherilyn seems to be pleased with. I'll go ahead and do that. Mm-hmm.
We're going to flatten on the insurance budgets. Someone is added or taken off, or the town's contribution will be the same as
right.
in 2019 as it was in 2018. That's all I have. Thank you.
What are you having next?
The last meeting, you asked me to look at the work that Belt Forestry did around Lynch Hill.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of our work, and actually, they did a really good job. Just disappointed that they didn't go all the way around. Some of the water bars they made 4 years ago were pretty bad, and they didn't do anything with those. So at some point, I was gonna call Jeff, Lyman.
Lyman.
Lyman, and just have to have the doors in there, and why didn't you just keep on going instead of stopping, but not being a chance to call today, but then, you know, if we talk to Jeff, or if we have to respond to their permit request, I think, we should tell them that the, you know, the bars that they made 4 years ago, or they need work to be done on them.
So Katrina, you're gonna get that to Jeff and Forster? Any else, sir?
Yep, that's all.
Chris?
Yeah.
Oh, good. All right, we'll cover that later. Tom?
Yeah, also on the finance committee, we wanted to come in next meeting, if we could.
That's a good time for that. Any else, Tom?
Yeah, I'll be attending a workshop for tree wardens that has to do with assessing the health of trees in town right away, so I think that'll be a good thing, so I'll go to that. And then at quarterly water meeting at the, with the Vermont Clean Water Network, and one of the things that I brought back to the Central Vermont Clean Water Committee that we met last week was that things just are very fragmented, and Vermont Clean Water Network seems to be, I'm not gonna say ignoring, but not really focusing on all of Vermont, so it's really just the Lake Champlain Basin. And there was somebody from Springfield, Vermont there, and she voiced the concern that we should be looking to the Connecticut River Basin as well. So I brought that back to CVRBC, and so hopefully we can tackle all of Vermont rather than just the Lake Champlain Basin. But basically everybody's, you know, for the clean water, and we all have the same goal. It's just that if you go on like the pull up Vermont Clean Water Network website, they list all their partners and everything, and you can click on one of their partners, and they talk about all the great things they've been doing, and it's just too much. And I think that there just needs to be some consolidation and you know, a little bit more cooperation. And I think that came across, because several people brought that up at the Clean Water Network meeting, which was last Tuesday.
I think Mike was starting to work with the Winooski River Conservancy a little bit better than what they have.
Right.
But then you've got you've got the Connecticut River Conservancy. Do they have a conservancy?
I don't know. I don't know if they do. I'll have to check on that website to see if their logo is there or not.
Regarding the timber or whatever, do you evaluate the timber on our town land, or do you just deal with it right away? How quickly trees?
No, I pretty much just the right of way so far.
Just curious. Watches our land as far as the health of our.
Yeah. Right. Mm-hmm. Yeah. No, that's a good point.
We have a forestry plan.
Good. Yeah.
We have a forestry plan. Take a look at the forestry plan. Take a look and see when, and the forestry plan has when it's supposed to be cut and everything. So I'll take a look at that and see what it says.
Do you know when that was updated?
Yeah, that wouldn't have been updated with the Emerald Ash Borer.
It would not. No, it was probably 10 years ago, which is not unusual for a forestry plan.
Well, that's a good idea. Take a look at that because of the Emerald Ash and such.
I don't believe there's that much ash on our town land. I think it's mostly softwood, but it'll tell how many ash trees in the stand and everything. Mm-hmm.
Right. Anything else, Tom?
No. That's it.
Just wanted to talk about that job description. It's like that's coming up later.
Yep.
That's it.
Trina, there are a couple things in here, bulletin boards.
Yes.
So all boards have notices on them for 3 weeks. One, you want to go with this?
Yep, they all had them for 3 weeks, nobody's called or anything. The one on Jones Brook Road is garbage, it just needs to be taken down and thrown away. The one on Cobb Hill is one of our official posting places, and it's the wood-wise, it's in good shape, it just needs to be painted. And then the one on the mountain road is in good shape, but I think that we should take it down and repurpose it and put it in front of the office, where I believe that was the original plan to have a kiosk board out there anyway. Because it said the wood is in good shape, it just needs to be cleaned up and painted, which I have paint at the town hall, so I could do that if you guys would take it down and bring it to the town hall.
We are going to have a kiosk, but we were going to have a bulletin board.
Yeah, yeah.
What use is made of the Cobb Hill one?
I post everything on there, the agenda, everything I do at the store.
That is one, as a board, when the open meeting law, that is one of our official posting places. The Cobb Hill, here, and the Moretown General Store. Our three official posting places.
Well, I'd like to see a bulletin board, I'm sorry. I'd like to see a bulletin board on Jones Brook, but I agree with you, the one that's there needs to come down. We need to reevaluate where it should be.
Well, yeah, I mean, maybe if it moved locations, but like I've had signs up on it saying that it was going to be removed.
Yeah, no, I think it should come down. I agree.
I think it's on a cold, damp place.
I think if it was at the end of the road, it would make a lot more sense.
Yeah, maybe Randy, you guys are over there, that talk to some of these people or whatever.
Yeah. Make a good sense. Makes sense. The reason we chose that location is we wanted to get the people that turned on the Ward Brook. Mm-hmm. Really, the best place is after Ward Brook, somewhere out in there where it's flatter. But we can see. I'll work on that.
Okay.
I agree. It should be taken down before it falls down.
So can someone ask Martin to order?
Can we put that in the lot? Email to Martin, sure. Kind of a to-do list.
Yeah.
Because the other thing is, we're talking about boards. The sign for this town office, now, is that still over?
It's laying against the building here.
All right. Actually fixed it. It's ready to go up.
All right, so maybe in that same email, do these guys see
my office sign is still here. Okay.
So the sign on the mountain road?
Yep.
That was also posted that would be coming down?
Yeah, yeah. It's nasty, needs to be cleaned, but it looks like it's almost a new 4x4. Like it hadn't been that long ago that it got fixed, maybe. Mm-hmm. And the sign itself is not, it's not rotten or anything.
Is that good?
Mm-hmm.
All right, so we also have somebody from John Riley, it's on Greg Negroni, looking to be reappointed as an alternate to the DRB.
So moved.
Second on that?
Second.
Based on seconds, any further discussion? All in favor, vote aye.
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 All right, auditor position.
She's coming in.
All right, so we'll hold off on that.
She should be in around 7:15.
Kind of much on this is on the right of way, I think. Ray will let us know.
Oh, that's the one we just talked about.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So that's the one.
And this was the heart of the union, so we've already discussed that as well.
I have a request and communication.
Yeah, okay.
Charlie Abear called on the phone this evening saying that at the corner of Cook Place and Old Hollow, a tree was taken down, I think by the sounds of it today. And his property state was right there, and now it's gone. So
in that same email to Martin, mm-hmm. just to make sure that state is replaced. Anything else, Cheryl?
Nope.
All right. I've been looking for approval of the 10-1-18 meeting minutes.
Can I make a motion?
Second on that? Anybody?
Nobody likes it?
It's all right, you don't have to be there, you just have to second it.
I'll second it.
Thank you. Any further discussion besides the people that were not there? All in favor, vote aye.
Aye.
All righty, do we have Denise and Leo here?
When they, I will say though, when they came in and talked to us, they asked to be on it, and then I put them on, but then they still had a conversation with me about how Lynch Hill got fixed, and I explained to them how Lynch Hill got fixed, so maybe they forgot their position, possibly.
All right.
Because they were like, well, this one got fixed, and I said, well, this is how that. So.
I thought maybe that had something to do with it.
Yeah, it sounded like it.
They were looking for extensive work on the road, culvert change and everything.
Going.
So when I looked into that, that's a class 4B.
Mm-hmm.
So it's slightly under a trail.
And yeah, we have worked with when Woody owned the place. I mean, we worked with him.
And that's he has said that. He did say that.
Yeah, we helped him out, but I don't think the road. I went up through there yesterday. I thought the road was in pretty good shape, actually.
I think, but like I said, when he first asked, he was thinking Lynch Hill got done by us and not by our program. So.
Yep.
All right.
But that does remind me. I forgot to bring up Jeff Ledoux. Yeah. So, what was the agreement last year? That was it?
Martin brought one load, you know, to share between Jeff and Avery. I don't know if there was any agreement, John, to tell you the truth.
Yeah, Martin talked about it and he said that they did bring on a load last year.
Yeah.
And he said that the stuff that he got from Du Bois can't get it anymore. So he said if he takes one load to him, he's going to need to take a load to Charlie because Charlie won't need a load as well. So
yeah, well, we'd say, why are we doing loads of anything else? Right.
All right. So I guess the answer is
no.
Class four, something like that. But no, I think last year there was.
There wasn't a road
problem. Right, there was an erosion issue.
I think it's a trail, not even
a
class four.
Right, it is a trail.
Somewhere there, I guess.
And hopefully it's also a trail.
All right, let's move on. Old business. We have the ambulance service. I tried to release to John, it's all crowded here when I get to hear this. So does everyone have the information for the ambulance?
I made more copies that I didn't do. Although I still have them, the ambulance. So I still have them with the ambulance.
You may have this one.
I had them at the last meeting, but they're not really.
They're not the ambulance. No, it looked like this in front of it.
Yeah.
This one's mine. Hold on, let me go grab my shirt.
Here's Trina.
Donald. They were in the pocket somewhere.
They were in the
pocket. Oh, that's right. I put them in old business.
Imagine being in old business.
I was supposed to go
shopping. Alrighty. So, Cheryl or Trina, do you want
to? Well, I have something that I want to talk to you about this ambulance service in executive session, so I don't know if you want to talk about anything else about them first, or if you want to.
Does one impact the other?
Yes, it impacts your decision.
Alright, so we're going to go ahead and do that first.
So, I request that we go into executive session for contract negotiations where premature general public knowledge would clearly place the town or the water ambulance service at substantial disadvantage.
I'll, so move. Is there a second?
Second.
John, any further discussion? Pardon me, much John. All in favor, vote aye.
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 Thank you.
So.
However, we will continue to discuss or take up the discussion of the ambulance service. So we were discussing or talking about Waterbury. This is the first year that they've requested money from us. Now, Katrina, you, they requested per capita. Can you discuss that number?
Yep, they requested per capita, which for the state of Vermont is, it's 1.8 person per household. So that's how I figured out the population that each person served was based on the 911 maps and then our tax maps.
Right, but initially they had incorrect.
They had 370 for their population served, and I came up with 285. I don't believe they ever told us a whole number. They just said 19 per capita,
mm-hmm.
which
yeah,
with 19, the math comes yeah. out to 5415 mm-hmm. per year.
Well, it seemed to me, based on the information they have, they weren't really sure what they were asking or what they needed because they didn't know, they haven't got this information as far
mm-hmm.
as how many calls they've actually made.
They only for 2017, I asked for both years. Oh no, sorry, it was Waterbury gave us both years. It was Matter River that didn't give me both years. So it's proportionally the same as Montpelier, who serves more people.
Certainly, I don't think anyone should be doing service to us without being paid. I mean, I think we owe something, but I'm not sure whether 5,400 is really that figure I'm looking for. Do we have more of a standard that we've done with different organizations that, services like even the fire departments or things?
All just done by negotiation, I think.
It's done by mutual aids between
right.
the fire department. If they're called, Waterbury would call Moretown if they needed to go. There's no charge.
And John, you were at the meeting, correct?
Mm-hmm.
What are your feelings as far as if we came back with we allocate $2,500 or something like that?
I think that they would take it.
Mm-hmm.
I hate to say this, but I'm not comfortable with giving one volunteer organization money and not others, and that opens a can of worms.
Mm-hmm. I was kind of thinking the same thing.
And likewise, recommending that they submit an article in town meeting, because that opens the same can of worms. But why does Waterbury qualify more than Member Ravel?
Maybe they need to supply more information, like financial reports and things like that, and a number, more financial reports than the town more time. The equipment that they have, the calls that they make.
Yeah, well,
the money that they get from Waterbury, I think, was like $57,000, right?
Mm-hmm.
From the town of Waterbury, the city Waterbury.
They're in, their budget's included, just like ours is included.
Right.
But they are volunteers.
They are volunteers. Their stipend's a lot more, though.
Yeah.
So I don't
but it's
know.
Not, but it's, I mean, we're not paying the firefighters, so we're more reimbursing the other town for the use of their equipment is what I look at.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, mm-hmm. That's a good point. So,
and just like if, I think there's mutual aid, there's something
mm-hmm.
between the other things that we have here in the valley, but that being not, I really don't want to ask them to, all right, we're depending on your equipment, but I'm not going to
mm-hmm.
provide any upkeep mm-hmm. or money for. And that's why I would $5,400 out of the back of $2,500 until it can be more, I don't know if we, I mean, we've been a matter of the rally, the North Field, I guess, the North Field of Wisconsin, it calls
no,
here, but.
No, it's just a town.
We can just.
It's up to the board. There's a meeting coming up, I believe it's October 30th.
I mean, I would bring back, you know, personally, I would think if we allocated up to $2,500, we can go back and I'd say, look at our board is, and we can talk about the fair, this just, bring back to that board. You know, we have questions about volunteerism, and, you know, we have a lot of that. We don't pay for that.
Right.
And so we're looking at this, reimbursing you for the use of that equipment. And what is it, what's the point?
Do you see that as different from what Med River Valley Ambulance Service does? And if so, why?
Well, Med River Valley also charges its customers.
Well, so does Water there.
Yeah. I don't know if they're not, receiving as many, you know, like my in-laws, there's a lot of places or a lot of people that will pay $100 for the whole year. I don't know. I mean, it would be nice to know if Waterbury does that and how much money they make off that before you. That's what I was thinking.
That's where I was thinking with the financial reports.
All right, so maybe if John, if you can go back and then request.
Right, but.
Yeah, I mean, I can. Actually, I owe Mark Hodgway an email so I can email that we want to see the financial report.
Very good. Why don't you copy Katrina on that, because she's been.
Yeah, I've been talking
about that as well. Yeah, we're hoping you get together on that. It's a good idea, thank you.
Do you think we should ask them directly, why do you think you're different than Med River Valley?
I think we need to get into that.
I would guess that Med River Valley has operating expenses.
Sure.
But I'm guessing they make it quite a bit from the ski areas.
Yeah.
To cover their operating expenses, whereas Waterbury does not.
I think that's correct, yeah.
I can find that out too.
Once we're opening,
I'm pretty sure
King Worms. Right. But to make it fair, I think we don't want to start. All right, let's go ahead and move on. The Nemrick quote.
No, there should be
no questions. Then I got. Anyone like some Reese's up back there? We're ruffling this bag along. Mike?
Are you trying to bribe me now?
Since 2011, even though this is a copy from 2012, plus the new stuff here, the top three pages. Not plus. This is the new total.
Right, and that's
the current contract's $8,190.
Is it $7,800?
No, well. Not include, but maybe contracted outside the scope of this.
Well, the price has gone up since 2000. It's gone up from $650 to $750.
Oh, that's the difference. Okay. The insurance has been changed.
The contract is the price.
Gotcha. So the current, yes, the current is $8,190.
Yeah.
The contract hasn't changed.
So we lose M. So we lose M.
asked Cheryl the same thing on that, because it didn't go far enough. She said, M is assist the town with administrative functions such as growth and downloads and state processing. So that is because NIMRIC, if this goes through, as you see on here, the cloud services, the state downloads will go right to the cloud services.
So they don't have to show us how to use it, they just do it. What is that, right?
Yes. They'll be doing state downloads through the cloud system.
So there is no longer a Moretown download from state?
It would go right to the cloud, right to NIMRIC.
So the new scope of work doesn't say anything about what they're doing on the cloud for us?
Gosh, Carolyn talked to Ed Claude, this is who the came from. And he spoke with her about what was happening with the cloud.
But it doesn't seem to be documented there, is it?
No. Yeah, the difference, Jimmy, is that they take out Worcester involvement and just say that they're doing it.
Mm-hmm.
And then M is missing.
Yeah, I saw
and
that.
And then there's...
If you have specific questions, I can ask them, but...
Mike, have you had an opportunity to look at this?
Only briefly, last week I didn't get a chance to really study it or see what it entailed, all of it. Cheryl and I did have a question as to whether this contract included the work that our current consultant is doing or whether it didn't, which would affect the total number of hours.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if you get a chance to clarify that.
I haven't clarified.
Mm-hmm.
I was waiting to see what.
Mm-hmm.
Could we get Mike a copy of the stuff too? Because if we're doing stuff that are impacting these guys and working with them, these guys need to, I think I'd like to have you and Deborah take a look at this and go over it, making sure that things aren't, you know, because I want to maintain, personally, I want to maintain our listers what we're doing, but try to figure out how it works here and what it doesn't. So. I want to keep you guys involved on this.
And then schedule a time in the future for them to come in?
Yeah, we need to, because this is probably the next meeting if you...
I don't work pretty full next
time. All right.
We've got six guests already coming.
Yep.
Now, last time,
let me know when we're done with that. When are we going to come back?
Oh, yeah. I think they said 2 years ago.
As far as we're taking a look at this stuff,
yes.
Yeah, we have a couple.
It'll be the 19th.
It'll be the 19th. And then we'll finish up the discussions on this.
Yeah. I may be recalling you correctly, but I thought last time we were able to answer the question that this number did include everything that they were currently doing. So.
And I did ask Cheryl on that, and she said yes, everything plus the cloud. But I, like I told Mike, I said, I don't know what you do or what you need to do. There's no bits and pieces here and there, but I'm not a lister. So.
Make sure it's all quick so I can call working together. And I mean, you don't have to talk about it now, Mike, but
Yeah, just said if it's appropriate.
Yeah, sure.
I think I heard you talking about the next time you bring this up would be the 12th. 19th? Yeah, I'm out of town, I'm sorry.
That's okay. First one in December, the 3rd.
You know, you're getting us now.
I actually, hang on for a second, basketball is in season now. I don't know if I have a practice scheduled that night, but I can probably work around it. Let me just look quickly and see if I have.
We can make it earlier or later, depending on basketball night, as far as the time.
All right, great.
Let them know. Hey, you need to get out.
I'm just packing them away.
Good devil.
You have more chocolate? Have some chocolate.
I mean, chocolate.
I have two on there.
So we're good with that, Mike? Everyone else around the table?
Yeah, I just haven't had a chance to review this.
Oh, yeah, sure, no, that's fine.
And then December, I'll make myself available one way or the other.
Okay.
Good. And can you pass that stuff on to Deborah?
Yeah, we're meeting tomorrow, so I'll show it to her.
Thank you very much.
And I'm gonna put down 7:00 because I know that Deborah's not available on Mondays until 7:00.
Okay.
Okay?
Yeah, and I can, with enough notice, I can work my schedule.
Consider 7:00. All right, so let's go ahead and move on to Montgomery Timber Appeal News. Kelly.
So I went to court last Monday.
Yep, the 8th.
Yes. And what they talked about was continuing the discovery process right now. They wanted the map that the select board based their decision on, which is where the email from Paul came from.
Mm-hmm.
Because in going through the process, the judge did not want them to get down to where she was going to have to make a decision or there was an agreement and there was confusion about where the trail was. Because...
Not the blue trail, but the blue trail. Okay, though.
Which is what we were talking mm-hmm. about.
Right. And Travis's attorney was talking about if that, depending on where it was, affected his part in being a party to this.
Which it would.
So I think they were hoping that maybe it wouldn't.
Sure they were.
So it would not be a party
yeah.
in the case.
Mm-hmm.
So that was most of the discussion. But the judge said,
okay.
I want
mm-hmm. all the facts.
All the facts. Mm-hmm. All the facts to be clear, all the parties to have all the facts, mm-hmm. so that when it comes down to decision making time, there's no confusion or gray area
mm-hmm.
in making this up or in somebody looking at it again later and saying, well, it was based on this and
mm-hmm.
we're looking over here. So.
All right, so again, we have, based on what we talked about earlier, I will certainly call Paul first thing in the morning to clarify that what they're talking about on the paper is what is actually 17 or what mm-hmm. 17 is.
Mm-hmm. Kelly, do you recall the judge's name?
Judge.
Yep.
Anything else?
Any worse?
I was with the court calendar and thought the judge would be calendar.
I think he, and I'm sitting in the front.
All right. Thank you, Kelly. Thank you for attending. And any other questions on that? Discussed? No. All right.
So I think you have William here and from the new employee from the library.
All right.
Stopped and then introduced himself.
All right, so why don't we go ahead and Rayan?
Hi.
Why don't you come on up here?
Love the hot seat.
Yeah.
Hello?
Hi.
I'm Rayan.
It's nice to meet you.
We're friends.
Yeah.
So you submitted a letter of interest for the town auditor position?
Yes.
And tell us a little bit about yourself.
I am born and raised Vermonter. I've lived in Moretown for 9 years. My husband and I bought the old Bruce farm and conserved the land. We farmed it for a while, and a lot of life has happened in our family, so we are taking a little bit of a sabbatical from farming. And I'm subbing at Moretown Elementary. My daughter and my son go there to preschool in fifth grader. A million years ago, I used to work at a bank. And I know how to balance my checkbook. I do my master's degree in education. That helps. I don't know what I need to become a town auditor.
I think shares that you get out are shows that you can learn.
I think the
job description. You know, you don't need to be an auditor to do this job.
Right.
It's overseen Katrina's got right to it, and she had no experience.
Well, and it's seen first by like true auditors.
A fourth check.
Yes.
Yeah.
Really, you know what you're doing. So you're putting it together in the town report.
Yeah.
And such, and making deadlines. You know, for us even. Things like that. That's where a lot of your responsibilities will fall.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's not on the numbers.
No.
Okay.
she's come in and talked to Cheryl, so Cheryl's given her the whole lowdown already, too.
All right. Any other questions for Rayanne?
No. Sounds good.
Okay, I would move to put Rayanne in the auditor position.
Second. Okay.
Second over here, Callie. Thank you. All in favor, vote aye.
Aye.
All
right. And then we do a woo.
All right. Your first town position.
Get, what is it, sworn in.
Yes, we do an officer.
So we swear.
You work, you can, anytime Sharon's here.
Okay.
I
promise that I'll try to be as serious as possible.
Thank you
very much, Ryan, for coming in. Appreciate it.
We're here for you.
Nice to meet you all.
Taking the time.
I'm trying to research the last year.
So, someone, our new librarian.
You know why?
Hey, come on up.
So, yes, I just don't have one order of position.
Learning a lot of new things. I love one.
My name's Anne McClucky. Assistant librarian, and I'm loving it so far. I live in Roxbury. It's my first librarian position. I'm an avid library enthusiast and very excited to get started and be most beautiful little library and see how I am.
When did you start?
About 3 weeks ago.
So you met a lot of townspeople?
Yes. Yeah. 30 years so, which is good. I also work at Redhead Bakery in Middlesex. So I've been in the area and I've been working there about coming on 7 years. So I've been in the area for a long time. My husband works at Pomeroy's Cemetery in the Hagefield. And we moved to Vermont in 2011. And we moved to Warren at the time and ended up buying a house in Roxbury. So, yeah. Pretty rooted in the area, but have a big circuit. We have a 1.5-year-old daughter, and
I hope there's a lot of energy at the library.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of good things are happening there, so I hope you can continue that.
I'm excited to be a part of it.
Mm-hmm. Well, we're always here. If you guys have questions, the library, you know, I'm sure they've told you we're fairly open to come in anytime.
Thank you. It's an interesting thing here last minute. It's just learning a little bit. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you for the time to come in. We appreciate
Thank
it.
Thank you.
Cheryl, I was just thinking they were just here to absorb the meeting.
That's okay.
Really wanted to see us. What actually happened.
It's so another possible victim.
She does not say. She can't. Yeah,
oh, well. All right, so the next thing on old business is the town administrator position. I know JB had some interest in this. JB had sent me an email in the last week or at some point asking for updates. JB, yeah, come on up. I'm sorry. I said JB, he's kind of. So I know the last time we met, we discussed some things. Jason was working on some stuff that we all contributed to. So this is not something that Jason has just come up with. There's questions, concerns from everyone. Jason's been the administrator, of course. So Jason, do you have anything you want to share here?
Yeah, so much of this depends on which job tasks are assigned to which job and how many hours are assigned to which job.
Okay.
And I think that you collectively did an excellent job of tailoring those job descriptions to meet your particular skill sets. Now, the question is, what is it that we want to do? Do we want to open these things up to bids to see what applications we get? And if so, what should it look like? Because that wouldn't necessarily be the same set of description items for each position if we opened up. One thing that's pretty obvious is most jobs for a full-time job are 40 hours a week. And if you were to sort these positions out to make the town administrator job 40 hours a week, then it kind of breaks everything else. And that was what I wanted to discuss.
Yeah.
An example of that, first, the way the hours break out for the proposal that we put together, which works fine for the 3 of you, is that is for the assistant town administrator.
Do you have copies of that, Jason?
I do not.
Okay,
have
that's okay.
One of it.
No, that's okay. It's easy to send them back.
There isn't much here,
okay.
So it's easy to go through. So what was proposed has the assistant county administrator 20 hours, the town administrator 28 hours, and one zoning administrator 10 hours, and E911 1 hour, website 1 hour, and then a few of those are matched together to make a particular job position. Now, if we were to start off with the assumption that the town administrator is a 40-hour week job, that makes the remaining work something that really would fall to one part-time position. You end up with 10-hour zoning administrator,
mm-hmm.
1 hour E911, 1 hour website,
mm-hmm.
and the assistant town administrator functions 8 hours for left after putting 40 hours into the town administrator position. I don't know that that's necessarily the direction we're going. That would be having a normal 40-hour position.
Mm-hmm.
So I was trying to think of how to approach this as something to open up to what's out there and still remain open to your proposal.
Well, good. I thought we had bumped that up a little bit, but the truth remains, at least certainly at this time of year, that you know the zoning work is. I mean, I
mm-hmm.
do my work pretty professionally, so you know, to even ballpark at 12 hours at most times of the year, I mean, I would have more hours than that indicates that it's two such a position.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought we could discuss that a little bit, but no, and I understand what you're saying,
right.
For sure. Yeah.
Now, these estimates came only from the number of hours that you had worked out for the job
mm-hmm.
descriptions that you had worked out. And then moving that around to see how we end up with a 40-hour town administrator. Now, that said, I think that the resulting halftime position has a very odd mix of skills in it. I don't think it's a very practical thing to go out for. You end up with a half zoning administrator, half assistant town administrator. It doesn't really work that well. So one way to do this might be to advertise the job and say that these multiple job positions should be looked at and come back with a proposal about which tasks the job will apply for would include. Because you can mix and match these indefinitely. So I'm trying to think of a way.
That struck me too. I understand what you're saying when I saw that. I mean, the truth of the matter is, I didn't go to law school or practice law to be a zoning administrator. Mm-hmm. This is something I came back to do to raise children while my wife were. So I'm looking for more. And so, you know, whether it be here or not, I'm not going to be zoning much longer because, it's one thing if you work over in Stowe or up in Burlington or other, bigger areas. There's just more going on. The salaries are better. With law school loans and all that, my education. I guess one possibility would be to potentially fund another zoning administrator. Just mm-hmm. if I were to want to pursue a full-time TA position, mm-hmm. which I am. Just kind of where I'm at. I absolutely agree. I understand what you're saying. That does make some sense.
Thoughts?
Jason and John?
So, you would foresee 40 hours just as town administrator?
I would, yes.
Okay.
Without me?
No, without.
Well, you wouldn't use an assistant if you were working 40 hours.
I was referring to without the zoning, but I mean.
Well, because our hours are split between assistant and town administrator.
I was just saying, I could.
You would take it at 40 hours.
Yes,
is what you're
exactly.
Saying.
Okay. Not without anything
yeah.
else.
Yeah, no, I get what you're saying. Yeah.
Yeah, Jason, what you said is that makes sense in this group. We really need to figure out based on that now because it's different than the proposal originally.
Mm-hmm. What I'm trying to do is come up with a way to have your proposal on the table and at the same time go out for public bids to see what other interest there is and do a comparison. And that's pretty difficult because the job structure that you proposed was designed for the three of you, and it works very well for that. But what to compare it to?
You also have very limited time. There's so mm-hmm. much in the last 2 weeks that she should have been training someone to do that I'm the only one there learning it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, Cheryl's not out of here until July. Yeah. So that's, we still got mm-hmm. a few months. I agree we need to make sure that our heads aren't in the sand, but I think this is something that we need to make a hasty decision that sure.
Well, there's one thing to keep in mind, is your budget.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think it needs to be done before budget time, and that's what we've talked about, because we've got to figure this out mm-hmm. and then budget it for mm-hmm. the next session.
In the meantime, it seems like I should be prepared to look elsewhere.
I don't think we're turning down the proposal.
Well, I think the proposal in and of itself wasn't quite, we could shore that up a little bit more. I had followed up with Katrina saying that at the very least I should be over 30 hours a week in that. The TA position.
Yeah.
To be quite honest, I've been doing zoning for so long that it doesn't sit on my thumbs. And
that was after
the application.
Right.
So, and certainly, the E91 E91 coordinator, I was done before by Shane Gray. So there's little things that certainly could be done to shore that up. I think the way it looks right now seems a little bit.
Yeah, we talked about it.
Jigsaw.
After.
It's a little bit of a jigsaw puzzle, so I understand that. At the same time, $70,000 in law school loans I got to start working on. Now that the kids are about to be in elementary school, it's just the path I got to take. So, I hope we can stay here. I too absolutely understand if you need to put it up in bid, and there probably are qualified TAs out there. So,
I think you'd be a very viable candidate when you've been here. You look at a lot of things when you're looking at
position. And there's, you know, we look at dynamics, office dynamics, and things like that. And you know, there's a lot of good dynamics with all the gear. And with, to Jason's point, trying to look at ways to make things work here. And we also need to look out for the best interest in the town.
First and foremost.
And, you know, and if it's, you know, 40 hours a week and a 15-hour a week job, or however, that's going to have to be. But I don't want to say kind of bait or we're doing anything. I really value your services, all of you folks.
Mm-hmm.
And I understand it can be a little frustrating dealing with a board.
Yep.
And, you know, we are slow at what we do. You know, and it's not our, you know, some of the things in our town just aren't a priority. Mm-hmm. You know, Ray had a road washout. John has a financial customer. I have a hospital that needs something. Jason's got, you know, a state budget. So it's, and Callie, you know, she's got a DCF, it's got kids, and she's applying for new jobs. So there's tons of stuff. And so we're sorry that sometimes those priorities, and I understand because John's putting money or taking bread in someone's pocket, I take very serious. So I apologize if it feels like it's no, because it's, you deserve the respect, and everyone does. That we take this serious, and we do. It just sometimes takes a little bit longer because, you know, it's not something we're not professionals do at this job.
Yeah, understood. I think that can be reworked. I don't think that was be set in stone. And I certainly. Mm-hmm. I feel like it'd be more valuable here as a town administrator than I can as a part-time employee.
Right. And I think what this exercise was good is, was we have all that, we looked at that information. It looks good to me, it looks good to Ray, it looks good to John, but all right, let's have someone and take it, really analyze it, and Jason did to figure out, you know what, it kind of doesn't work so well. But now let's figure out how to make it work. So why don't, and I know we have a lot going on in the next meeting, but because it is important, so why don't we put 45 minutes of executive session for the board to work at the end of the meeting just on this issue. And Jason will send out what he's got, but we need to really seriously at this next meeting come back with some ideas of what we want this to look like.
I think that's a good idea.
Because it really needs to, we need to wrap it up by the end of the year and figure out the bodies that we're doing it with.
And I think you put it very well. It's a jigsaw puzzle.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And which pieces go where, it depends on who. And I feel kind of obligated to look outside, but that doesn't mean that we don't know you best.
Mm-hmm. Right.
But how to do that with these different pieces of the job isn't something that I really figured out.
Sure. Yeah, and I mean, to reiterate, planning and zoning is not what I'm.
Put that in the back pocket and do it. Anything else? Town administrative position, any comments, concerns, questions?
I hope that when you're looking at this stuff that you'll ask questions.
Mm-hmm.
I don't see how you can possibly know. You say that somebody does something, but I don't know how you can possibly know how long it takes to do some of these things.
I have absolutely no idea how long it takes to do each item. The only numbers I know are the aggregate as presented to us. So no, I don't know the individual hours.
So don't worry about
it. And I can't even ask for it. I don't think it's
regular board. I mean, I think if we have questions, and it's not just falling all on Jason. I mean, it's everyone's responsibility around this board. And, you know, we pass our stuff to Jason, Jason being kind enough to put it together.
I mean, that's why I gave you a year. You know, because.
Optimistic.
Yeah.
No, it's not that. I mean, you're going to have questions on how long it takes to do the things that were proposed.
Yep. Very good. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yep.
Okay.
Thank you.
Tomorrow.
All right. So now let's put down until old business continue. John, can we hit everything on the finance committee?
Yes. Right, Jason, you reported.
Jason, yes.
So you need to actually appoint Sherilyn, right?
You did.
Did you do that?
You did.
No, I don't think we.
No.
No,
we just said,
right.
Get to the finance committee.
You said you'd get to it. Yeah.
Because it already do it. So I'd move to appoint Sherilyn Brown to the Finance Committee.
Second.
Jason seconds. And any further discussion? All in favor, vote aye.
Aye.
Aye's got it. All right. So let's go back into new business, LHMPB bid opening. Excuse me.
These 20 items.
We received one quote from Central Vermont Regional Planning Commission. Defined my scope of work very clearly. I read it all. They covered everything in the RFP. 32 pages.
How many people did we send that out to?
We sent it out to only one requested it, Central Vermont Regional Planning Commission. It was in the papers, and it was on the website, and it was Facebook. Only Central Vermont Regional Planning Commission called and asked for it.
I see the RFP.
Mm-hmm. These people all work together anyways.
Yeah.
Questions? I know Jason's a lot there, but for John on that.
How much is the grant again?
$10,100.
What a coincidence.
So the RFP requires for a qualified consultant. Mm-hmm. The Central Vermont Regional Planning Commission fall into that category?
Yes, if you look at their RFP, they're...
Okay. Are they... I never would think of them as a consultant. They're a planning commission. You know, to me, they're on different levels.
You'd be surprised. They have grant specialist Pam DeAndrea is a archaeologist.
Yeah.
Okay. Engineer. Yes.
Engineer. Yeah.
Senior. She's a senior planner.
Yeah.
So that's the grant. This is. Clear through.
Yeah. Is it that map that looks down in the right room, so it just doesn't look like your body or something on the scale?
I think so. No. I don't think that they, that's why I put $10,000 on there. Right. That's what we had. Mm-hmm. And didn't want you to have to open up $40,000, $50,000 RFPs.
Mm-hmm.
Well, they are the only bidder and would appear to be the only, or the winner, they're the only winner, or the only bidder.
They're very qualified to do it.
Well, I know we've worked with Pam before, and they've done, they've provided a lot of assistance to Pam, so, yeah, I would go ahead and...
They know our goals.
So, based on that, based on the only bid, I would move that we go ahead with the Central Vermont Regional Planning Commission for the Hazard Mitigation Planning Services.
Second.
Any further discussion? All in favor, vote aye.
Aye.
And now, Shirley, you want to talk about town budget, set a definitive amount to everyone? Is there a place to sign this one?
No, they'll send us a contract. So you have your budgets in front of you so far of what we've received. Oh, before you go any further, I did this again. Is this how you want it? Or do you, it was actually Tom Badowski that requested it like this, but I did it again because I thought it was easier to read than the other one.
Mm-hmm. Oh, that's good to me.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Right. I like it.
And I was actually able to put more on this one.
Mm-hmm. Okay, Cheryl, go ahead.
Yeah, we don't have the town office one yet because we don't know, I haven't had time to sit down with Sherilyn. That one's been, it was pretty busy. We have the town hall, we have the library, we've got good places for you to start anyway on what we have so far.
Is there anyone that wanted to come in and discuss
yeah.
their...
Yeah, let's see. Martin is going to be coming in next meeting. The rec committee's coming in next meeting. The library won't be coming in unless you want them to. Their budget really hasn't changed from last year.
And we're seeing enough of them.
Mm-hmm. There's also that other one there, Tom, too, with their different options in front of you that the library sent with their budget.
Oh, okay.
So the library total must be 28,000 for that.
It was 85,15 does not work.
Oh, it looks like the
right. Wow,
what a deal. It must be 28.
Oh, I see. It doesn't include the numbers on the previous page.
Right. Oh, my bad. I'll fix it. It's not much different than... It isn't. It's 4,000 different from what they took out...
Well, no, I mean, if that's the total on the second page, then we're looking at 22,100 added to that. So that's 30,600.
That's about 2,000 less. Because they took out 1,700 out of building maintenance. $22,908.
Is there request?
Yeah. I have to do this all by hand. This isn't like automatically generated.
$22,808 is on the first page.
$22,000.
No, she said that was the total.
But
that,
no,
that's the first page, yeah.
Yeah.
It's like what? It's like 30,600 and something.
Just
a couple thousand less.
31,426.47. Well, I'm thinking about combining something. I'm trying to get the work to see what you think. When a department comes in to talk about their operating budget, can we also ask them to be prepared to discuss their upcoming capital needs?
Mm-hmm.
And do two birds with one stone?
Mm-hmm. Good. Yeah, very good. When Martin comes in, I think you'll have a capital need. That's the only one that I know for a capital need. this year.
Yeah, but I'm asking for a few years out.
Yep.
To the best of your knowledge.
Do you have me scheduled on one of the upcoming meetings, or was I supposed to do it then?
So.
For what? For looking at the budgets now.
Yeah.
Yeah, they're looking at the budgets now, so if you've got anything you want to explain.
Yeah, I can tell them what I'm asking.
Well, let's, before you go there, let's, we're at the library right now, so I have some questions. We have library pay at 14.1. What's, what percentage increase is that? And it'll be over, is it hours or money, what's the difference?
I don't think it explained it.
So that would be a question there, it's just, are we looking at increased hours or more pay?
2%.
It's a 2%?
2%, okay, same for assistant librarian, or what's it, more?
Yeah, but she.
No, that's not, never mind.
No, but you're looking at the actual, yeah.
$59.67, 2%, so she rounded it up to $6,000.
Like, the portal, there's nothing more to go in there.
Do we know why the highway crew pay is gone?
Wait, so we're on library here. Yep. And they're thinking that the building maintenance at $350 is enough?
They don't have any big things anymore.
$2,000 was budgeted before, because remember, we were replacing the windows, we were trying to replace windows.
Telephone, that's right.
Well, yeah, but I mean, if they stay in the library.
Yeah, but there's a whole new, different thing for that. There's a whole other chart for that.
A what if?
Okay.
There's a as is moving and if we move budget.
But I think for this budget year, we need to look at this as just as is, because anything that new is going to be on something.
Yeah, which is why she said to do it that way.
Yeah, so we gotta just look at.
So they have a separate.
Yeah, so now we can take home and you can't sleep at night. But in the meantime, we're gonna concentrate on what we got this year. So it looks like overall, they're looking at about $500 less than they were last year. So I'm okay with the library. If anyone else has any questions, that was 2% on the, and that's something that we'll look at as far as pay. You know, we'll do that all together, but for all intents and purposes, they can keep it 2% at this point. Ray, I know you were jumping ahead to kind of break those questions down or think of those. Martin's coming in. So there's no sense of wasting time on, you know, thinking about what it could be or couldn't be. Let's wait until we get the guy here that can answer the question.
Very sorry to say, the state raise was 0.65% for the upcoming year.
Really?
For this current.
0.65?
Yep.
So it's not even cost of living. Well, we can take that under recommendation. So another, while we're right here, town reports. Any question on town reports? No, so let's check off. We got the library checked off.
You did skip the town hall on the first page.
So let's get that to the town hall.
I was just gonna bug you.
I know, it was like she reminds me of a little chihuahua. Oh, yeah, I love it.
Now, give it to me now. Yeah, that's a chihuahua.
Don't put that in the
thing. I will.
She likes it.
She knows.
All right,
questions, or do you want me to just start talking?
Do I have a choice?
No.
Wait a second, so let's start at the top.
Okay.
Custodial wages.
So the hours went up. Before it was only scheduled at 63 hours a year, and I moved it up to 92 hours a year, which is only 1.8 hours a week. But I think that if that had been being done in the past, we wouldn't have so many problems as we have.
Mm-hmm.
It's also...
You know, and you are, it seems like you're spending the time you're doing.
I do, that's about what I've been doing
so
far.
You're doing a good job.
Because I asked for a 4% raise. Just in that position.
Well,
just so you know the difference between
all right.
the two.
All right, so in that, no, that's good. I want to know that. So in this hours, just increased hours, how many hours?
Went from 63 to 92.
63 up to 92.
An extra 29 hours a year.
All right. And that pay going up? Is this wages from?
1601 to 1663.
So why do you think that should be?
Because I think it's not just clean. I think that's like a quarter of what I do. But just the ideas that I have, that if it does stay the same, I have a lot of ideas on how to promote it. And I already did the whole table and chair thing, and I've made more than what I'm asking for in a raise in a week. I think that if it stays the town hall, that we can make more money off of it. I used to do event planning, so. And it's a lot cleaner than I used to be.
How'd you come up with the 1663?
That was, 1601 is what I made, right?
Right.
And then I did, how did I do that? 1601. I think I did turns. I think I did 2% and then 2% is what I did. Because I had it at 2 and then I said, no, I want to ask for more. And so I did it again. I think that's why the math doesn't add up. So if you actually did 1601 times 4.
And how many hours a week? You said 1.9 or
it's like 1.8 hours a week.
And I just, the reason I want that too is thinking about what we're, other stuff we're working on. It's going to get 12 hours that you do.
That I don't hear.
Yeah.
So well, yeah.
I'm doing commission?
Yep.
All right. FICA, there's nothing there.
So the building maintenance.
Mm-hmm.
So what I have factored in there is the rest of the painting and the basement floor. I have factored in the cost average of, I don't know if you remember when I gave you all those different flooring options that could possibly go down there. The average of them was $2,500. So it's just the cost of the material plus my labor. But I didn't add labor in there. I just did the material cost because I'm sure I can work it into whatever hours I'm already working. You know what I mean? If there's new floor, I'll clean a little less. So I'll spend time putting the floor and cleaning a little less because it's cleaner. Does that make sense?
No, it
does. That's all that's in building maintenance. There's a lot more that should be done.
And there was 5,000 painting.
It's like 51 something. For the, actually I have it right here. So the basement floor was $2,500 is what I was asking for. And then the outside paint that's left is $5,889.87. And then there's a few things that happen every year, which is the fire extinguisher service, the elevator service, and then the heating service. That's another $840 of that is service that happens every year.
Mandatory.
Yep.
Yeah. Okay, I'm painting on that again. I'm not happy at all about the painting.
Me neither.
We should, I think, have invite this guy in to a next meeting or a Zoom meeting, find out what the plan is and it makes sense to for us to go forward with this guy.
Okay.
I stopped the other day to take a look at the building. It's not a very good quality job, especially on the back side.
Yes.
And there's things that were done that clapboards that he was supposed to replace that I haven't been replaced, that he was up, yeah, it was up on the cupola.
That one side he had it done. He did the three sides because he couldn't, he had a problem with the neighbor and the lift and the
right,
back.
But what he said to us is, this is how he was going to do it.
Oh, I totally agree on this.
And so I want to talk to him about that
yeah.
and find out what the deal is. But we need to finish, so I think that number's probably a good number.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't know if he's the person for it. Supplies, that was true.
Oh, yeah, okay. There's a thing I want to, that has a lot of good reviews that I want to try on the wood floor to make it last longer because it's not sandable. I believe the last person that refinished it said it was the last time it could be done. And this is a product that they use on gym wood floors to restore its shine, and it's supposed to last for like up to a year. So it's 100, the bucket itself is $150. So that's what half those supplies are, is to try to make.
Have you talked to anyone that's used it?
I've only read reviews, but there's, I don't know, like over 5,000 reviews. Okay. Yeah.
What's it called?
I have to look it back up. Yeah, I don't have it on me.
So that's part of the.
Yeah, it's kind of like a pour-on thing. You just use, you know, a wet mop and spread it around and then let it dry. It doesn't have to like level or anything like that. It's just supposed to, you have to clean it really good first, obviously.
So just a little if you have a chance, yeah. Just out of curiosity.
Sure.
But the floor was still a success?
The floor would still need to be sanded some.
No, this stuff is, it's made, that's, you're not supposed to have to, because gym floors have all the painting lines, so that you don't, that's the purpose of it, is to avoid sanding it. Yeah. Yeah, so obviously there's stains and stuff, but the floor, I mean, it's not, there's no real big discolorations, it's just, it's not shiny, so it never looks clean.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. When it's wet, it's beautiful.
Yeah. And we're obviously no debt retirement there or interest, so there's some savings. So I think town hall looks right aside from signing the ladies
yeah.
at this point. Oh, so there is debt.
Oh, there will be. Oh, I hadn't talked to you about that yet. That's what it is.
All right, so we're not going to be saving that $10,000.
What was that? I missed that.
There is debt retirement.
There is debt retirement that has to go in there. Mm-hmm. Well, it's going to be significantly less than this year. Because there's $30,000 from this year.
Oh, you mean the total budget?
Yeah, the total budget. Yeah.
Okay.
Not the debt retirement, which is not in the actual Yeti.
Yeah, that's what the numbers will be.
Yeah.
87, 80,
that's
principal.
It'll stay the same?
Pretty much. The interest will go down a little bit every year. You pay it'll go down.
Okay.
But you can put those in back in numbers until we finish.
Okay. That was, I didn't ask you that yet.
All right, so we're on the service. Jason, did you have a question?
No. Mm-hmm.
All right, so auditors.
Yeah, that one's mine. It's pretty much, I did a 2% raise on that one too. Everything else is the same almost. I think I went. It's the CPA bookkeeping services has gone up and that's it. So it's nothing that I have. That's still, it's like not even that many hours a year.
So it's up maybe 10%?
The $4. Not my mind ever feeling.
I'm sorry, the CPA we're keeping so.
Yeah,
the CPA itself didn't go up. It's a NEMRIC that balances the checkbook and stuff that actually checked that the CPA wanted done. They've gone up a little bit for an hourly rate. What the process is when the bank statements come in.
Mm-hmm.
The treasurer doesn't open them at all. That's what the CPA wants, the auditor guy.
Okay.
They're done online by NEMRIC, and then our town auditors open up the statements and review them as part of their auditing.
That's the only thing.
Mm-hmm. Right. Person. And you spot check invoices.
Yes, yeah, but on basis, yeah, you're right.
All right, so is everyone good with auditors? Listers, they want to come in?
Not unless you've got a problem with what they put in here. It's, they have two new items, the last two on the bottom. The 500 you've already approved, the tax map, the pensions, I think you approved those earlier.
Yeah, the index in the last meeting, the meeting before. Did we do the dimensions as well?
That's when Don Buxton came in and you agreed.
That was, no, remember, that was the mistake in my minutes where I said it was something, and it was supposed to be more.
This was the total, they agreed to do it for $3,000, what was in your minutes?
Yeah.
$3,000. They agreed because that's what was in the minutes to do it for that. He said, you know, the tax dimension should be five, but they agreed to do it for three.
Will that be an every year thing?
Yeah, if you want the numbers to change on the tax map, yeah. The $500 there is just for the index. So if you came in and looked up Ray Washburn.
Right.
You go in there and you find your acreage and you find what tax map it was on and you find the latitude, longitude, all that stuff.
So if we went with the new NEMR contract, the totals would be roughly the same as the first two lines under Listers now?
You can't do without your Listers altogether.
Right.
Yeah.
Right, so if that was, if the top number was $2,000 more and the bottom number $2,000 less.
You still have to have something in there for Listers.
Right, but I think what he's saying is it would be 2,000 there for Listers.
Yeah.
And then 2,000 up onto the consultant.
Yeah.
Closer to three than the one. Close.
I'm sorry, closer to three, actually.
Yeah.
Right, well, that would be, we'll have to wait until we figure that out and move that number around, but at this point, that may change. Other than this, first two, we may have to make a decision on that, but everything else looks all right. Next week, now, this planning commission, DRP, SLAP, that looks good.
Cemetery will be for that.
Kind of put the treasurer waiting on that. Select board. Obvious that those two. Yeah, that's all. The rest of that is on us when we figure out what we are doing with that position.
We can give ourselves a 0.675% raise.
Not without asking the auditors.
Really?
Honestly, no.
Yeah.
You're going to make the request of the auditors.
Actually, auditors hold the highest power in the town.
Scheduled to get out of here at 8:10, so we're already over a little bit.
Stephen's scheduled to come in too, isn't he?
Stephen is coming in on the 9th.
Yeah.
So could you let him know to be prepared to talk about capital?
I think
yes. For future meetings.
So why don't we hold on budget now if everyone's good with that?
That was good.
And everyone, and tell everyone thank you for getting stuff in. Thank you for everyone.
Yes.
Paying attention. We have a few things to sign tonight. So I have already signed this when Mike was here. This was what they're making changes to the grant list, 2018 grant list. So you guys can take a look at that. Those were based upon grievances. Now, this is, again, you've been following in what Cali said, or he was going to sign off on.
Okay.
So if you guys can go that way with that. So is this the state telling us to check the bridge out? I read this, and it's safe, or?
Attention needs to be done to the Hops Bridge. What they're doing is, with that, is they're saying, okay, the state's notified the town, now if we don't do something about it, someone gets hurt, the town is liable. I talked with Martin about that.
They're only signing that front copy of that one night. You don't want to sign the next.
I'll sign the one that says 11.
Right, just the first page.
That's one.
Okay, I talked with Martin today. Yeah, don't sign the one on the bottom. Just the one on the top. That one, the reason for that is you'll sign that other one. I've got it all ready for your 11:15 site visit. And what I believe Martin is going to call Bill and Cody and Jay McDonald, whoever, and see what it would cost to fix that bridge. See what their recommendations are. Do we have to replace the whole bridge? Whatever, and then when the grants come out in February, we'll apply for a grant. That's...
Which bridge is that?
By Hops Road.
Where's the
Hops Road? Oh, okay.
Yeah.
On the back side of the mountain.
On the mountain road. Well, we did some work on that a few years ago.
Salaki.
Oh.
That's where I was thinking too. But it's over that, so we're in the same place, isn't it? Or in the same...
It's down to the north, further.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, for the last one, or second to last one on the left, if you're going to...
This is... Is that a class three? Is Hops Road a class three?
It's not on Hops Road, it's on the mountain road.
It's just near.
Okay.
It gets really narrow right there on that bridge.
Well, as long as we're following up on it and doing what we need to do, to make it safe so that we're not reliable.
Mm-hmm.
And then that's it, I guess.
Does the whole board have to sign that, or just you?
I think I just do.
Can I see that one?
Well, there's Callie and John. There's paperwork right there that you need to fill out.
Yeah, I got Callie's, John. This is yours.
Did you give the old bridge to
What's that?
Did you give the old bridge to budget?
Yeah.
Did they look at the bridge thing,
guys?
Yep. So, we're going to put you in charge of that one.
Okay.
Can you want to start with that, please? Before next time, the biggest thing is really take a look at that, the town administrator stuff. We don't want to let that go any further.
I'm on the same line, Tom. I'd like to spend some time at the next meeting doing all this personal policy revisions. We've gone over it quite a few times this year, and I think we need to.
You know what, why don't we incorporate that into that whole discussion, that 45 minutes, because I think a lot of that will be in the executive session as well.
Yeah.
And that kind of ties into everything, includes, Cheryl retiring and stuff. So, yeah, I would agree with you.
we ate a lot of chocolates.
So this was the other stuff from the library. What you guys think you have? It's nothing to be acting on. These tax credits, is this just from the, because of the changes and the corrections?
No, it's for prebates that have come into the town.
Yeah. I'm surprised that those are around. Checks here, so you gotta sign off on them. So,
there were a lot of objections when that method showed up in the legislature and just blew right past it.
Yeah, I guess if.
Is everyone in the wall set? Jason, I'm supposed to give you.
Yeah, just one item back on the letter to the school board. I think it would be nice to just let Gabe and Linda know that they're sending that. So
I think that's a good idea.
Yeah.
Or I think, you know what, let me know what we're, make sure we're probably sending out something that we're, what we're doing as far as what we're looking into at this point. But yeah, John, I think that's a very good idea. Yeah. Very good. And I think that's, I appreciate Peter coming in and making that.
I'm part of the high school visioning coming again tomorrow night. I did the middle school one, and they asked me to do the high school one tomorrow night as one of the Moretown residents.
All right.
Yeah.
Keep yourself busy there.
Yeah.
Good work, Jason.
Perfect.
All right. All right, I move to adjourn.
Second.
All in favor, aye.
Aye.
Thank you, everybody.